This is the podcast for Earth Science 7th grade for Unit 4, Chapters 2, 3, and 4 regarding weather and climate. First up tonight is about wind. Remember, wind is the air that moves along the ground or evenly parallel to the ground. And this is actually caused by uneven heating of Earth's surface, which causes pressure differences, and that sets the air going in motion. Over a short distance, that moves directly from high pressure to low pressure, like you see here in this picture. All right, in the picture you can see, so number one here, that is where warm air rises. So when the sun heats the ground, it's going to cause a warmer air to happen above that surface. And that's going to cause that warm air to rise, which is going to cause a low pressure area underneath. And then over in another area, the sun heats the area of the ground, but not quite as strongly. This could be because of clouds in the way or because of indirect sunlight. And so that colder, dense air is going to sink slowly, and you're going to get a high pressure area that's going to form. And then, of course, the wind is going to move from across the surface from that high pressure to the low pressure. All right, uneven heating is also the cause of global winds. Now, the uneven heating between the equator and the north and south poles is going to cause those global winds to occur. So here at the regions that are closer to the equator, they're going to get a lot more sun. That concentrated sunlight is going to cause warm air, which is going to rise and produce a low pressure area. In regions closer to the poles, they're not going to get as much sunlight. It's going to be more spread out. And because of that, the air above that is going to be colder and denser. Now, the sinking dense air is going to produce those high pressure, and that combination, those low pressures and high pressures, are going to set the global winds going. Now, if we did not rotate, the global winds would flow directly from pole to the equator and back. But because we rotate, the direction of those winds and other objects, they're going to move across our Earth. This effect is called the Coriolis effect, and those global winds curve as Earth turns beneath them. All right, there are major wind belts that actually go across our globe, and these are named according to which way they blow. For instance, our westerlies, these travel from the west to the east. The easterlies travel from the east to the west. And then the trade winds actually occur down near the equator, but they never actually touch the equator. Sea and land breezes occur near our shorelines, and these are caused, again, by uneven heating. So as the sun heats the land, it's going to happen faster than the sun heats the water. Now, this is going to cause the air over the land to rise and expand because it's hotter, and that denser ocean air is going to move into that area where the hotter air has moved away. That's going to produce a sea breeze. At night, the situation reverses. Land breezes occur instead because the land is going to cool down faster than the water, which is going to cause the effect to reverse. Next up, we're going to talk about clouds, and the first thing we need to do is just briefly go back over the water cycle. Remember that evaporation and condensation and precipitation are the three main components of the water cycle. Remember that water evaporates from bodies of water, vapor condenses to form clouds, and then it falls to Earth's surface as precipitation, and then it continues that cycle. Humidity is the amount of water vapor in the air, and this is, again, going to vary from place to place and time to time. And while the air gains water vapor, you're going to see more water vapor that evaporates than condenses, and that air is going to eventually reach the saturation point. Now, when that happens, you're going to get the rate of evaporation and condensation as equal, and any additional water that evaporates, it's going to be balanced by the water that condenses. In order to form clouds, we have to have condensed water vapor. So as warm air rises in the atmosphere, it's going to cool down in that convection current that we've talked about. When the air cools to that point where it's called the dew point, it's the point at which the temperature into the air reaches that saturation, then what's going to happen is that water vapor is going to condense, and it's going to start to form little tiny droplets, or possibly ice crystals, and those droplets are going to be so light that they're actually going to float together as clouds. However, in order to make a cloud, don't forget you have to have one other little thing, and that's some sort of particle, some piece of dust, some particle of something, smoke, salt from the ocean, something, in order to have that condensation occur. If you don't have that particle, it can't condensate because there's nothing to condensate on. There are a few different types of clouds, and these clouds are going to vary based upon where they form within the atmosphere, as well as what the clouds look like and what they produce. The first type are cirrus clouds. Now remember, cirrus is the Latin term for curl of hair, and these clouds actually look as if it has a piece of hair that has been curled up slightly. Cirrus clouds are going to form high in the atmosphere, and they are going to be blown about by the wind. Typically, they are a sign of fair weather. However, they can be a sign also that a storm is coming. The next type of cloud is a cumulus cloud, and these mean a heap or a pile. These are the type of clouds we typically think of when we're thinking about clouds. They're puffy white little clouds. Typically, they have a darker base, but they look like little balls of cotton floating in the air. However, if a cumulus cloud is to grow big and tall and go further up into the atmosphere, these are going to produce showers. In fact, the tallest clouds, which are cumulonimbus clouds, are also known as thunderheads, and they produce thunderstorms that drop heavy rainfall. Our last type of clouds are stratus clouds, and this means that they're spread out. These clouds are flat and long, and they tend to form when there's not a lot of air movement. These stratus clouds can form and produce light, steady rain, but not those heavy thunderstorms that the cumulus clouds can. Now, another part to remember about naming clouds is that there's a couple of words that can be added to them to describe other aspects of them, such as if they're going to produce precipitation, you're going to add the names nimbo or nimbus, and if they're from a medium altitude, you're going to add the prefix alto. Our next section is on precipitation. Remember that precipitation is going to come from those clouds we just talked about. Now, precipitation occurs through the combining of cloud droplets, like what you see here in this picture. So these cloud droplets are very, very tiny. They're microscopic. And as they combine together within the cloud, they're going to start to form a raindrop. That raindrop is eventually going to become heavy enough that it's going to fall out of the cloud and fall as precipitation, which, as we know, is any type of liquid or solid water that falls to Earth's surface. Now, another option is instead of those droplets coming together and forming a raindrop, it could also form ice crystals. And those ice crystals are going to also form into other forms of precipitation. So in order to get some form of precipitation, we must have cloud droplets combining or ice crystals growing and each of those becoming too heavy to stay in the cloud any longer and falling to Earth. Now, some precipitation is going to freeze or melt after it falls from the clouds. We're going to talk about those five different types of precipitation. The first type is rain or drizzle. Drizzle is a very, very light type of rain, and these typically fall from stratus clouds. And the next one is freezing rain. Remember that freezing rain actually comes down as a raindrop, but once it hits the ground, the ground is so cold that it freezes. Sleet is rain that then passes through a layer of cold air, which is going to cause it to freeze before it hits the ground. And these last two happen within clouds. Snow. Snow is actually where the ice crystals grow together and merge in the cloud before they fall, and those are going to become snowflakes within the cloud. And our last type is hail. Remember, hail are those big, large chunks of ice, and these actually occur again up in the cloud. And these form because they actually come down into the cloud, and then there's a gust of wind that blows it back up into the cloud where it gathers more of the crystals, and it keeps doing this cycle over and over again until it becomes so heavy that the wind can no longer push it up and it's going to fall. Our next unit is regarding weather and air masses. First, remember that air masses are large bodies of air that are defined by the temperature and the moisture involved in them. Scientists classify air masses into categories according to the characteristics of the regions. The first word of an air mass's category name tells you whether the air mass was formed over water or over dry land. This describes the moisture of the air mass. Therefore, continental air masses form over dry land and therefore are going to become dry and lose moisture to the dry land below it. A maritime is going to form over water, and that air mass is going to gain moisture from the water that is below. The second part of the air mass's name comes from how close to the equator that the air mass was formed. There are two names within here. The first is tropical. Tropical means that it was formed near the equator, where the air mass is going to be warm because of gaining energy from the warm land and water from being near the equator. The second one is polar. Now, polar air masses are going to form far from the equator, closer to the poles, and these are going to be cool as it loses energy to the cold land and water. And our final section is on climate. Remember that climate, this is different from our weather that we hear about from our meteorologists and so forth that do our weather reports. Weather is just the temperature and precipitation that is occurring right now. Climate is how the area changes over a long period of time. There are four different things that are going to affect the climate of an area, and these are all based on geography. The first of these four items that affects our climate is latitude. Remember that latitude are those lines that are parallel with the equator and they go from our north to our south pole. Now, because of the sun's uneven heating of our Earth's curved surface, this is going to change the way the heat that we get from the sun is spread throughout our globe. Near the equator, the sun is going to hit the surface of our Earth pretty much straight on. However, at the poles, that sunlight is going to strike it at a lower angle, so it's going to be more spread out, and that's going to cause those temperatures to be cooler. Altitude also affects climate, and as we go up higher into the troposphere, the air that is around you is actually going to become cooler. This is based upon the fact that the sunshine that comes down is going to heat the land, and that land is going to lend heat into the air through conduction, and then of course convection is going to occur, and as that rises it's going to begin to cool, which is going to cause it to be cooler at higher altitudes. Being near water can also affect the climate of an area. Because the land heats up and cools off faster than water, those areas that are closer to water are going to take longer to heat or cool. This causes those areas that are closer to water to have milder temperatures than areas that are farther inland. Marine climates are those that are close to water, and these areas are going to have temperatures that do not drop very far at night. Summers and winters are going to be mild, and they're going to receive a steady amount of precipitation because of that wind blowing in off the oceans. Continental climates, however, occur on the interior of the continents, and these are going to have weather patterns that are going to vary greatly. These areas are going to typically have much colder winters and much warmer summers. Our fourth geographical item that affects climate is ocean currents. Now, ocean currents, as we know, those are going to be influenced based upon where they're coming from, such as our warmer waters are going to come from our equator, and our colder waters are going to come from our poles. These ocean currents are going to cause changes in the climate by transferring that energy from one part of the ocean to another part of the ocean. Seasonal changes are part of our climate too, but seasons are periods of the year associated with specific weather conditions. Remember, these are not based upon the time of the year. They're with how the weather conditions change. They're going to vary based upon where in the world you are. These seasons are going to vary in the northern and southern hemisphere because the amount of sun that they get is going to change over the course of the year. Our Earth is rotated on its axis by 23.5 degrees. That 23.5 degrees tilt causes our seasons to change.
like us in the United States, we're further up in the northern hemisphere. And as our Earth rotates, we are going to come closer towards where the sun is directly striking during our summer months. And then in the winter, we're going to be up towards the northern part of our tilt.
Climate change is one of the biggest controversial issues that are facing our Earth today. There are multiple things that can cause climate change to occur. Many of these are naturally occurring, and some of them are not. The first of the naturally occurring is that you see here in this image, and that is that when certain events happen here on Earth, it can actually block the sunlight's ability to get to Earth and heat our planet. A volcanic eruption can occur, blocking the sunlight, and this can last upwards of a few years, causing the temperature of our Earth to decrease. Space objects can also do this, and again can last for a few years. Climate change can also occur when the continents move, such as when we started out as Pangaea and moved into our current configuration. As the continents move from their original place, they're either going to become closer to the equator or closer to the poles, and that's going to change the climate of that location. Because our continents move at an extremely small rate, this change will last thousands of years. Ice ages are another naturally occurring result of climate change. And what happens here is that the amount of ice on our Earth can either melt or increase based upon the climate that is going on around the world. These can last tens of thousands of years and can change based upon the amount of carbon dioxide in our atmosphere, which can change the amount of greenhouse effect we have. Climate change is set to increase as we continue to affect our atmosphere. Climate change is also known as global warming, and global warming is affecting our world, and we predict that by the year 2100, there's going to be a massive change in our climate because of the amount of human activities that release greenhouse gases. This global warming trend is going to cause major changes to the ice on our world. This includes melting of ice sheets that cover countries such as Greenland. You're going to get melting of ice in the Arctic Ocean and even on top of mountains in many parts of the world.
And that's the end of the podcast. So as always, good luck.